Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpinder Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 13th of February 2021 and we are going to start with our current affairs. So these lectures are basically helpful for those students who are preparing for the UPSC Civil Services examination as well as other government competitive examinations. These examinations require you to answer few questions related to your day-to-day events. For those you have to read the national newspaper like the Hindu and Indian Express. So both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer the Hindu newspaper for your civil services examination preparation. All right. And you can also subscribe our channel on the YouTube Future IAS, where we are bringing for you the day-to-day current affairs on daily basis. So you can always subscribe, always refer our daily current affairs on the YouTube. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay. So first is basically the Tholpava Kutu. The Tholpava Kutu is basically a leather puppetry show. So it is basically the famous shadow leather puppets, which are basically very famous in the Kerala state. Okay. So first time this Tholpava Kutu, which is a famous shadow puppets or leather puppets, will be telling the stories of epic Ramayana, right, with the help of robots. So this leather puppets will be showcasing the stories of Ramayana. So it is basically a shadow puppetry which is practiced in the Kerala state of India, and it is basically performed with the help of leather puppets. So this leather is made up of some skin, right? For example, this leather was traditionally made up of the deer skin, right? But now this leather is basically made up of the goat skin. Okay, so it is made up of leather. So these puppets are basically made up of leather, and this ritual is dedicated to the Bhadrakali temple, and it is basically performed to Devi temples, especially in the Kerala. Okay, so for performance of this Tholpava Kutu, leather puppetry show, right, there are special theaters which are called Kutu Mandams. These Kutu Mandams basically are those theaters where in the Devi temple this leather puppetry show is basically practiced, right? This year, or from now itself, this leather puppetry show will be showcasing the stories of Ramayana, right? That will be showcasing with the help of robots. Okay, and as I told you that this, especially the shadow leather puppet, right? This show will be more useful, or it will be more popular in Kerala state, especially in the Palakkad district, Thrissur district and Mallappuram district in the Kerala. And it is believed that this puppetry show was originated in the 9th century AD, right? And the basic text from which this show was originated was basically the Kamba Ramayana. So Kamba Ramayana as its basic text for the origination of this leather puppetry show. The puppets which are used basically in Tholpava Kutu is made up of the skin. This skin traditionally made up of deer, okay? But now the deer killing is banned, right? So the skin basically be used for the making of this leather puppets are basically goat skin. So now the goat skin is used for the building or for the manufacturing of these puppets. These puppets are also, painted with dye. So we use basically the vegetable dye for painting purpose of those puppets, right? As the vegetable dye lasts long, right? They are also, some sort of a durability with those dye. Okay, so you can see here, this is the shadow puppetry show. Here at the background, you have the leather puppets, which are basically controlled by the robots. Okay, so here you will have the leather, shadow leather puppetry show, which is famous in, in the Kerala state. Okay. Next is intercaste marriages. As you know that nowadays intercaste marriages are very common, okay, throughout the country. The people are coming out of this the social stigma related to the intercaste marriages, especially the youngsters, right? They are now breaking down all such rituals or such social barriers that were there, right, in our last generation. So now the generations are become more forward in terms of making their intercaste marriages. So these educated youngsters are showing a way forward, right, for the intercaste marriages, for the reduction of the caste and community tensions. because as you know that in India, there are a lot of barriers at the social level. First of all, you have caste-related inequality in the society. You have the division of the society based on the caste. Shudras, then you have the Vaishyas, then Kshatriyas, then Brahmanas. So you have the fourfold division of the society based on certain caste. And every level you have, numerous caste also. So the whole community is basically divided based on the caste. And there are tensions also based on the caste-related conflicts. Now to reduce that caste-related conflicts in India, the inter-caste marriages can be a way forward, right? As the Supreme Court also says in its recent judgment that the educated youngsters are basically showing the way forward to reduce this caste-related conflict, caste-related rivalries by doing this inter-caste marriages. Okay, now educated younger boys and the girls, right, which are, which can choose their life partner, right? And this is basically a departure from the previous norm or older norms of the society, where the older norm says that you should marry within your own caste, right, or own community, right? Now, these educated younger boys and the girls, they are departing from their, age-old practice, which are supposed to be married within their, caste community or, community within there. Okay. Now, obviously, if this way continued, that will somehow reduce the caste and community-related tensions by such inter-caste marriages. Okay. The Justice Cole basically also quoted Dr. B.R. Ambedkar's Annihilation of the Caste, the book which has been written by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, right? In which Dr. B.R. Ambedkar clearly says that according to Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, he was convinced that the remedy is basically inter-caste marriages, right? How will you annihilate the caste? You cannot simply annihilate the caste without, intermixing the people. So there's the best way to reduce the caste-related, complexities, caste-related rivalries is to do inter-caste marriages, okay? According to Dr. Ambedkar and Justice Cole, the fusion of the blood by such inter-caste marriages can create a feeling of, akin, right? And that will basically vanish the separatist feeling which are there among the caste, okay? So that will definitely vanish this type of feeling of, the separatist, and that will create a bond between the two opposition or between the two different caste people, all right? Here, most importantly here is that consent of the family and the community is not needed, okay? Once you are adult enough, that means you are adult, you are 18 years above in case of girl and 21 years in case of boy, right? You are free, right, for choosing your life partner. You can marry, okay? You can marry and it does not require the consent of the family and the community, okay? That means the adult individuals, they can agree to enter into the wedlock irrespective of the consent of the family or the community, okay? So the consent of the individual adult members who are going to be married, right, their consent has to be considered as a pious, and that is the reason it has been given primacy. It has been given primacy for such intercaste marriages according to the judgment delivered by the Supreme Court of India. All right. Next, the excessive alcohol causes irreversible changes to the DNA. Okay. So as you know that alcohol consumption is, very common. Many people are addicted to the alcohol, okay, alcohol and other related drugs. A study which was published by a National Institute of Mental Health and the Neurosciences, Bengaluru, the study published that if the people leaves, the drinking of alcohol, right, it can still, can damage the DNA, or it cannot be, the DNA which have been damaged due to the consumption of the alcohol, it cannot be reversed back. So the excessive consumption of the alcohol may cause irreversible damage to the DNA of the person. But definitely, certain health-related complications can be reversed if one stops drinking. But the changes which have done to the DNA of a person, that cannot be reversed back. Okay. So the changes in the DNA that can persist even when the person leaves the alcohol, right? Which is basically revealed by the team of researchers at the National Institute of Mental Health and the Neurosciences in Bengaluru. Okay. And this research is basically published online in the American Journal of Medical Genetics. which shows that certain irreversible changes would be done to the DNA of a person even if the person stops consumption of alcohol. All right. The study basically tracked the patients, right, which are addicted from the, you know, alcohol, right? So certain patients, right, at the NIMHANS, Center for the Addiction Medicine Outpatient Clinic, from 2015 to 2016. So these patients basically, you know, tracked, and they have studied based on certain, you know, parameters, right? Based on that parameters or based on that assessment, the researchers basically found that the genes we inherit from our parents, right, these expression of these genes in the particular person, right, is basically, you know, differ from person to person. So it is a unique manner that every person is having that impact of or expression of that gene. Okay. And this gene expression may be influenced because of the lifestyle of a person also. For example, if the person is excessively drinking alcohol, okay, then this excessive drinking of the alcohol can, you know, affect the pattern of gene expression. Okay. And that may also produce some sort of a symptomatic complications of the gene. And that is basically irreversible according to the study, which was conducted by the NIMHANS. Okay. And researchers basically analyzed that the DNA chemistry of an individual who have been drinking on an average of 10 drinks per day, right? So the researchers basically use those individuals which are heavily drinker or which are averagely, they are drinking around 10 drinks per day. Okay. Next, the arbitration in the Conciliation Amendment Bill 2021. Okay. So first of all, the arbitration in the arbitration in the Conciliation Amendment Bill 2021, which was introduced in the Lok Sabha, right, on February 4th, 2021, it has been passed in the Lok Sabha, right? So that means the Lok Sabha gave its nod to the Arbitration and the Conciliation Amendment Bill 2021. Okay. This bill would seeks to amend the Arbitration and the Conciliation Act 1996. So certain outdated, you know, provisions are there in this Arbitration and the Conciliation Act 1996. And there is almost certain other things which has to be added in the bill. So this new bill is, you know, introduced in the Lok Sabha to amend this Arbitration and the Conciliation Act. Right, this Arbitration and the Conciliation Act Amendment Bill 2021 would basically deals with certain arbitration related, you know, which are related to the domestic and international issues, right? As well as this bill also defines the law for conducting the arbitration proceedings. Okay, now our ordinance was also promulgated prior, right? With the ordinance was promulgated on November 4, 2020. Now there is a statutory provision that the ordinance is having certain life. If the ordinance, right, can be replaced by the ordinance, that is okay. If ordinance is not replaced by the ordinance, or the ordinance is not replaced by the bill, the ordinance will expire, right, within a certain reasonable period of the time. So here you have to either promulgate a new ordinance to continue the previous one, or you have to pass a bill. So here the government chooses to pass a bill. So this bill, which is known as Arbitration and the Conciliation Amendment Bill 2021, would replace an ordinance, okay? And that ordinance was promulgated on November 4, 2020. Okay. Now, certain important provisions which have been added to this, you know, Arbitration and the Conciliation Amendment Bill 2021. So this bill basically provide that the court can stay on arbitral award, right? The court can stay the arbitral award if it is satisfied that, you know, a certain, you know, relevant arbitration agreement or the contract, right, if there is a flaw in that, you know, certain agreement or the contract, okay, and if, you know, the making of that award or making of that contract is affected by the fraud or corruption, okay, then if there is a changes which affect from October 23, 2015. Okay. So any sort of a changes which are affecting in the arbitration agreement or the contract, which are incorporated by the fraud or the corruption, okay, the court have the power to stay on this arbitral award. Okay. Now, regarding the qualification of the arbitrators who would be conducting this arbitration and the conciliation process, now, there was a schedule for the arbitrators, right, regarding their, you know, the qualification and all sort of things. Now this bill 2021, this bill removes the schedule for the arbitrators, right? Now the bills provide that the qualification, experience and the norms, right, related to the accreditation of the arbitrators will be specified, the regulations which are made under this amendment bill, right? So the previous bill or previous, you know, the act which provides qualification, experience, now this schedule have been removed. Now it is says that the bill, according to the bill, the qualification, experience and the accreditation will be provided as per the regulations made under bill. Okay. Hilsa is basically a fish, okay, or a variety of the fish which is known as Tenulosa ilisha, right? So it is basically, you know, generally reside in the oceans and most of the time it's basically its lifespan in the oceans, okay? But sometime during the breeding time especially, right, or you know, it's a time to spawn, the Hilsa basically moves inside, you know, or towards the estuary, and it also entered, you know, some rivers also, right? So what happens is this Hilsa, which is, you know, famous for, you know, for the food and for the consumption purpose, now what happens is this Hilsa used to migrate from the ocean, especially from the Bay of Bengal towards the Ganga and towards, you know, to the upstream, up to the Godavari and the Kaveri, right, through with the help of, you know, the estuary. Now what is happening is that the project, though, which has facilitated the movement of, you know, the upstream Hilsa along the Ganga, is basically showing some results. Now what is happening is that because of certain, you know, barrages which are constructed on the way of Ganga, right, to regulate the flow of the river of the Ganga, now this barrages basically caused, you know, irreversible damage to the movement of the Hilsa from the downstream to the upstream side. Okay, for example, you have the Farakka barrage, which has caused so much problem in the migration of this Hilsa river from, you know, from the Bay of Bengal towards, you know, from the Kolkata, from West Bengal region towards, towards your, you know, the Western India. Okay, so it is basically facing so lot of problems in terms of their migration. Okay, so as I told you that Hilsa, in the scientific parlance, it is known as Tenulosa ilisha. It is basically an anadromous fish. Okay, and as I told you that most of the time the fish basically resides in the ocean, but during the rainy season, right, when it's, you know, breeding time or spawning time, the Hilsa move towards the estuary. Okay, where the rivers, right, of the Ganga and the Bangladesh both actually meets at the Bay of Bengal. So through these estuaries, this Hilsa or Tenulosa ilisha basically moved upstream side. Upstream side is this one. For example, this is the river of Ganga. Okay, this is basically upstream. Okay, and this is basically downstream. Okay, and this is basically, you can say, estuary. Okay, from the estuary it moves to the, you know, to the upside, right? So to the upstream side. Okay, so what is happening is that, right, towards the, you know, this, the treble upstream, especially in the Padma river, right, as well as in the Ganga, some of, you know, these hills are also known to be migrated towards the Godavari river in the peninsula, as well as to the Kaveri river to the deeper side also. Okay, now the Farakka barrage lock, which has caused the damage to the migration of those, you know, the Hilsa river, for example, the historic river shows that until 1970s the Hilsa could swim up to, you know, the Allahabad. So you can catch the Hilsa river basically up to the Allahabad and even to the Agra also, right? But what is happening is that after the Farakka barrage, which was installed, right, and become operational on the Ganga river from 1975 onward, this disrupted the westward movement of Hilsa. That means the upstream movement of the Hilsa was basically disrupted because of this Farakka barrage. Okay. And there is a lock which basically stops the migration of the fish from basically downstream to the upstream beyond the Farakka. Okay. In the Buxar, on the border of Bihar and the Uttar Pradesh, the last recorded catch of the Hilsa was made 32 years ago. So you can assume that 32 years ago, when this lock was not there, okay, it was recorded. But after this Farakka barrage, right, the Hilsa river has not been reported, right, at the border of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. Okay, so you can see basically some of the fish catch related to the Hilsa, caught by the fishermen. Okay. Then the alpine style mountaineering, right? So first of all, you must understand it is a one sport, right? Where the people basically participate in the mountaineering. Now what happens is in the basically to attempting, you know, to scale the world's second highest peak, that is K2, three international mountaineers basically disappeared, right? Obviously they would have killed in this expedition of attempting to scale the world's second highest peak, K2. These three mountaineers basically try to scale up this highest peak in the winter time. And obviously you must understand during the winter, there is a lot of problems in terms of avalanche, in terms of, you know, blizzards, in terms of other, you know, the storm related features, especially in the higher reaches of the Himalaya or higher reaches of, you know, this peak of K2. Okay, so here the alpine style mountaineering is basically one of the important phenomena or one of the important type of mountaineering. Here the mountaineers who basically undertook this expedition of alpine mountaineering, they only stops, right, for a minimal. That means they will have the lesser number of breaks. First of all, obviously when you go to normal mountaineering, right, you will have to stay at one place until you get acclimatized at that particular environment. Okay. Now, in this alpine style of mountaineering, the mountaineers basically do not take the help of or do not take the assistance of the porters. And moreover, they only stay at the minimum number of breaks, right? During this expedition, the mountaineers along with them, you know, carry all sort of, you know, the important things, right? For example, the food, equipment, tents also. But there is no scope of acclimatization. Acclimatization means the body get adjusted with the environmental conditions, right? Especially at the higher reaches, right? So what happens is, since these mountaineers basically stay at, you know, the lesser number of time for a minimum number of the breaks, so there is no scope of acclimatization. And it may take several days for the acclimatization of the body, right? But obviously this is not possible for those mountaineers who basically undertook this alpine style mountaineering. Okay, if you contrast or if you compare the alpine style mountaineering with the expedition or with the siege type of climbing, the people generally, you know, move from one camp to the another camp, right? And they move from the camp to camp basis, right? So that their body get acclimatized in the particular environment. So they will give, you know, enough time to acclimatize their body. But alpine style mountaineering is no such thing. They stop for a minimal period of the time, right? Without acclimatizing their body, and they move, right? And they basically, you know, basically climb very fast. The winter climbing is always a tougher than pre-monsoon, post-monsoon and the summer climbing, because lot of storms, blizzards, right? Avalanches are very common during the winter climbing. So obviously it is tougher and harder than all sort of other climbings. Okay. And many people basically, you know, consider this alpine style of mountaineering is the most aesthetically pure form of mountaineering, because it obviously involves the real challenges of mountaineering. Okay. And the benefit of alpine style mountaineering is that the people who are involved in the mountaineering, they spend very less time on the route, right? Why they spend very less time on the route? Because obviously there is also danger of avalanches, blizzards, or the storms on the way. So they generally stay very less period of the time on the route, right? And, you know, the problem basically encountered is because, you know, there is lack of the support during, if there is avalanche or there is blizzard. Okay, and there is also lack of acclimatization associated with, you know, with this type of alpine mountaineering. So here, a lot of people also may die in the absence of the acclimatization at that high altitudes of the Himalaya. So it is potentially very dangerous, but the mountaineers basically, they practice in such type of the environment, and they can basically, you know, can basically climb on such harsh conditions also. Okay. So here you can see one man is climbing or the alpine mountaineering, right? And it is just showcasing how the people basically, you know, climb on such steep hills. Okay. Next is AC 3rd economy class. So first of all, you must understand the background that the railways are getting their profit from the AC third class, right? So railways are getting the profit, or the AC third class is basically most profitable, right? To the railways, the railways are getting revenue from AC third class a most. Okay, now on the same pattern, right, the railways also planning to manufacture the AC third economy class. So it is basically an affordable and air conditioned version of non AC sleeper class. So here it will be looks like the sleeper class, but it is the air conditioned version of non AC sleeper class. It will be affordable to the middle classes also. So here a prototype of this new rail, which is AC third economy class, was finalized, right, for the introduction at the Indian Railways Research Design Standard Organization in the Lucknow. Okay, this class is meant to be affordable. Obviously it will be comparatively cheaper than AC third class, and it will be air conditioned version of non AC sleeper class coaches. Okay, now the job of creating this type of, you know, AC third economy class have been given already to the state owned rail coach factory, which is located in the Kapurthala, okay, which is also the maker of the Link Hoffman Bosch coaches in India. Okay, and the design philosophy which was used in this manufacturing of AC third economy class coaches, right, to take, you know, as a reference as the non AC sleeper coaches. So the reference is basically non-AC sleeper coaches, and ultimately try to refabricate into the AC coaches of such courses. Okay. And as I told you, that AC third tire is basically only travel class that makes the clear profit for the railways. Okay. And it is also most popular, you know. So AC third economy class is also would be more popular, right, among the people, because it will be affordable. And it will be the air conditioned version of the sleeper class. Obviously, it will be more famous and more affordable among the people. Okay, so you can see, you know, a prototype of AC3, you know, economy class, where it looks like as if it is sleeper class, but it is air conditioned version of the sleeper class coaches. All right. Then child beggars. The child beggars, as you know, that it is a rampant problem. Right, it is most common problem in India. In almost every cities, you can find the child beggars on the roads, on the footpaths. They used to come and they used to beg for the money or anything. Right. So here, the Union Minister of Women and the Child Development informed the Lok Sabha about the steps which are related to the child beggars, and to control the problems related to the child beggars. Okay. For that, a bill has already been passed, the Juvenile Justice Care and the Protection of the Children Act 2015. In short, it is also known as JJ Act 2015. It is the primary law which basically try to regulate the child beggars and other problems associated with the children, right, and their exploitation. So for example, the section 214 second of the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection Act 2015 says that a children who are found to be working in the contravention of the labor laws, right, because the child labor is not allowed, it is illegal in our country, right, and such children, if it's found contravention, right, in the conflict of the labor laws, or the children which is found in the begging, right, such children, right, would be included in the child in need of care and the protection, right? So such children will be considered as a child in the need of care and the protection. And regarding the penalties, Section 76 of Juvenile Justice Care and Protection Act 2015 says that the person who employ any children, right, for the purpose of begging, right, such person or such employer will be punished, right, with the imprisonment of up to 5 years in the jail, and that will also have the fine of 1 lakh rupees also. Okay, now the ministry implements the centrally sponsored scheme, right, which is also known as, you know, the child protection services, which are implemented under the integrated child development service scheme. This child protection services supporting the children which are in the difficult circumstances, for example, the children which are found destitute on the roads, or the children which are working as a child beggars. Okay, under this child protection services, which are provided under integrated child development service scheme, right? Institutional care will be provided through a child care institution. So child care institutions have been set up, right, at a particular locations in the district level. Okay, these child care institutions would be providing the institutional support and institutional care for the children who are found to be beggars or the destitutes. And such child care institutions would also provide the rehabilitation measures to those children. Okay. Then a scheme, this scheme also provides a 24/7 emergency outreach and the helpline number for those children who are in the distress conditions, right? And it has also the dedicated toll-free number, that is 1098, which can be dialed in anywhere in the country, and it can be, you know, reach out to those children who are in the distress conditions. Okay. Then the Ministry of Social Justice and the Empowerment has taken the pilot project for the comprehensive rehabilitation of the person engaged in the begging, okay, in the 10 cities. So the comprehensive rehabilitation of those persons, right, who are engaged in this occupation of the begging, right? So here, you know, the it include basically the education of such children as well as their rehabilitation in certain the child care institutions. All right. Then Swami Dayanand Saraswati. Okay. The Swami Dayanand Saraswati, you know that he is basically an Indian philosopher. Okay. He was born on 12th February 1824. And he died basically on the 13th October 1883. He was an Indian philosopher. He was also the social leader. He was also the founder of Arya Samaj. And he was also the reformer or who initiated the reform movement of the Vedic Dharmas. All right. So here in this background, the information in the broadcasting minister, Prakash Javedkar, paid a tribute to the Swami Dayanand Saraswati on its birth anniversary on the 12th February 2021. Okay. So the information, the broadcasting minister paid a tribute to his birth anniversary. And the Swami Dayanand Saraswati was the first person who gave the call of Swaraj. Swaraj, India for the Indians. Okay. In 1876. And later, this call of the Swaraj was adopted by the Lokmanya Tilak as well as the Indian National Congress also. Okay. And the Swami Dayanand Saraswati basically denounced the idolatry practices, any sort of a ritual worship which is conducted, right, in the Hinduistic society, right, as well as the Swami Dayanand Saraswati also worked towards reviving the Vedic ideologies related to the idolatry and ritualistic worship. Okay. And even the President of India, S. Radhakrishnan, also called him the makers of modern India. Sri Aurobindo also called him the makers of modern India, right? The person who are influenced by the teachings of Swami Dayanand Saraswati is basically Madam Kama, Swami Shraddhananda, then Shyamji Krishna Verma, Bhagat Singh, Vinayak Damodar Savarkar, and the Lala Lajpat Rai. Okay. And regarding Swami Dayanand Saraswati, he was basically a sannyasi, that means an ascetic from the boyhood itself, and he was the great scholar regarding in that. And he basically believed in the infallible, in the authority of the Vedas. So he has a strong belief in the Vedas. And the Dayanand Saraswati also advocated the doctrine of karma and the doctrine of reincarnation. Okay, so he was strongly in the support of the doctrine of karma and the reincarnation. Okay, and various contributions have been done by the efforts of the Swami Dayanand Saraswati. For example, he was involved in the promotion of the equal rights for the women. For example, the right to education, reading of Indian scriptures, right, to the women, as well as he also gave his commentary on the Vedas from the Vedic Sanskrit in the Sanskrit as well as in the Hindi. So he has lot of, you know, credit in his name with respect to the social reform, right, as well as the intellectual development in the society. Okay, so he was basically Swami Dayanand Saraswati. Okay, next is World Radio Day. So World Radio Day, first of all, you must understand it is celebrated on the February 3rd every year. So every year on the February 13th, the World Radio Day is celebrated. Okay, this radio day was first proclaimed by the members, right, of the, you know, the member of the UNESCO in 2011. Now, subsequently, this proposal was adopted by the United Nations General Assembly, right, has been passed as a proposal for the setting up of this World Radio Day on the 13th February every year. So it completed the 10 years of its anniversary, right? So this year, the radio has completed, or World Radio Day has completed the 10 years of its anniversary, right? And according to the UNESCO, the radio is a powerful medium of celebrating the humanity, because it is the mass, you know, through the radio, you can basically reach out to the mass. There is, you know, the audiences is basically, you can basically, you know, target the wider audiences. It can reach out to every section of the society, all right? And it can be listened by the people. So it is basically celebrating the humanity and constitute the platform for the democratic discourse also. Through the radio, you can always reach out to the people. You can discuss democratic ideas, democratic ideals also with the help of radio, right? It is also means of mass communication through which you can reach out to the people, to the society in the democratic world, okay? And according to the UNESCO, on the occasion of the World Radio Day 2021, the UNESCO basically calls all radio stations throughout the world to celebrate the 10th anniversary of the World Radio Day, because it was the February 13th to 2011, the first time World Radio Day was celebrated. Since then, it is the 10th such day which will be celebrated, right, on the February 13th, 2021, right? And the UNESCO already calls on all radio stations to celebrate this event as a 10th anniversary and more than 110 years of the radio in existence, because the radio was there even beyond 2011 also, but that day was not celebrated. So the day was celebrated since 2011, but the radio was existence by more than 110 years of the time period. Okay, this year the theme for the World Radio Day was the New World, New Radio. So this theme was New World, New Radio, which highlight the services which are rendered by the radio medium throughout the crisis. Throughout the crisis means this year you have the different crisis. For example, you have basically, you know, the crisis which are related to Corona, right? Which has led to, you know, so much, information which was provided by the radios. And in that respect, it has important medium throughout the crisis also. All right. So this is basically theme of the world, you know, Radio Day. All right. So that's all for the today. We'll meet again tomorrow. So till then, thank you very much for your session. Thank you.